Well, good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to see you here. We're glad to have you in the house of the Lord this morning for worship. I want to welcome you to First Baptist Church of Kernville. If this is your first time visiting with us this morning, in the chair in front of you, you will find a white Connect card. Please take one of those, fill those out. That gives us a record of your visit. If you have questions about the church or things you'd like to know, I'll reach out to you Monday morning and connect with you via that card. You can write questions on there if there's something you'd like to know as well. Well, this morning I'd like to welcome you here. I want to welcome back some friends who have not been here for a very long time, our former pastor Grant Bennett and Megan, his wife, and their children. They are here with us this morning. They are moving back to the Bakersfield area. He's taking a church in Bakersfield, and so they'll be around this area a lot more. So we're just really glad to have them here this morning. You know, Grant and I, we've talked on the phone a lot before I came here. We talked and we've bounced back and forth on text and in Messenger, but we've never actually met. So this morning is the first time we actually face-to-face met, and so it was really good to meet him and his wife. So we're glad to have them here this morning. We also have a special guest here this morning who are going to be speaking in our service, and that is our missionary Nathan Fogerly, his wife Becky, and their children. They're missionaries to Indonesia, and Nathan's a missionary pilot, so he's going to be talking about what the Lord is doing there and how the Lord works in that. So this morning, that's what we're going to be doing, is we're going to be focusing on the Lord's mission. So that's what's going to be happening here today. We have a few announcements for you. The first is this: after the service is over this morning, we're having a missionary lunch. So when the service is over, please come up and eat with us in the fellowship hall. Nathan and Becky will be answering questions. We'll have a time of fellowship in there, and that'll give you an opportunity to kind of learn a little bit more about their ministry if you still have questions. Some of you guys, you were here and watched the movie with us, Ends of the Earth. This is a documentary that was made by Mission Aviation Fellowship and Moody Bible Institute, and they're the stars of this. I would say that the plane is the star of this, or somebody else, but I don't really, I mean, they're featured really heavily in this film. A lot of you watched this as a great movie. This is going to be after this weekend. Somebody's going to take it today, but then after this weekend, this will be in the church library. So if at any point you want to check it out and watch it, I really encourage you to. You'll get a really great view of what their ministry is like and what they're doing, and see what their lives are like, to experience the dangers as well as the joys that come with, you know, doing missions to these tribes who have never heard the Lord or who are desperately wanting for somebody to come and share the gospel. So make sure that you check that out at some point. We may get multiple copies depending on how often it's out. So make sure to do that. Make sure to stay after with us this morning as well. Next to that, and with that, every time we have a missionary that comes in and speaks, we always take a love offering. So alongside our regular offering at the end of the service, on the back side, on either side of the door, we have offering receptacles. If the Lord is laying on your heart to help contribute to the expenses that Nathan and Becky accrue as they are here in the States, traveling around, going and visiting churches, just put that in an envelope. There's envelopes in front of you, and write either Missionary or Fogerly's or Missions or something along those lines to cue us into that's what it's for. And then all of that will go directly to them as a love offering. So if the Lord places it on your heart this morning to do that, put that in at the end of the service with the regular offering. We'll count that and get that to them before they leave. So love offering this morning. And then after the service is over, after we have done all the service, the mission lunch, our kids are going to have their Christmas play practice, so we're going to keep doing that 1 o'clock to 2:15 today. So for all of the kids that are in here, you guys will have practice this afternoon at 1. You can see the rest of the announcements that are in here. I just want to make mention, we have nominations, fall nominations for deacons, trustees, finance, or in salary treatment committee. So sign up for those or nominate somebody for that if you think that there's somebody who would be a good fit there. And we'll take those into consideration in the next month as we start to narrow that list down to people who are willing to do it. So if you write somebody's name up there and they're not willing, we're not going to force them to do this. Nobody's going in under compulsion. We'll actually, if they say no, then we'll let them go and they can wander off into the wilderness and do what it is they're going to do. But if they want to serve, they are allowed, they can do that. So notice this week there are announcements on the back as well. So make sure to pay attention to all of those and read those. Just stand for a minute, take a moment to greet those that are around you here this morning, and then we'll continue on in worship. Thank you.
Heavenly Father, we come to you today, and we pray that you would help us to truly live for your glory in all that we do. We just ask that you would be with us, give us ears to hear what you would say to us through Nathan. I pray you'd bless him, fill him with your spirit, and give him the words to speak to us as he comes to share the word with us today. And so we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, you may have a seat. So Nathan and Becky Foggerly have been missionaries that we support since the second year that I was here, 2017. I came here in 2016. 2017, we brought them in. We started supporting them as missionaries, and they are the first missionaries that we have ever supported that are not International Mission Board missionaries. So they are with Mission Aviation Fellowship, which is an organization that employs pilots to go out and fly into the jungles, out into the bush, and various places around the world. And so, you know, Nathan's somebody that I've known since 2000. When I started at Moody Bible Institute, he was on my floor. He and I were friends. In fact, the first Thanksgiving that I was at Moody, I took Nathan and a couple other guys, and we drove from Chicago to Alabama. And so, you know, they came and hung out with us for Thanksgiving. So he's a guy I've known for a lot of years. He's a man of godly character. We've come to know and love his wife as well. And so before they come up and speak, or before Nathan comes and speaks, I want to show you guys the trailer for the movie Ends of the Earth, because this will give you a good snapshot of everything that he's going to be talking about this morning. And if you haven't seen the movie, again, you know, normally I don't stand up here and plug movies from the pulpit, but I really want you to see this if you haven't seen it. I know a lot of you have, and a lot of you have just been really blessed by that, but we're going to show you this trailer for it, and then I'm going to have Nathan come up.
There are still parts of the world in the 21st century that are utterly unreached and isolated. To have an airplane come and serve a place that's never been served by it before has a profound change on that location. MAF was born to go into the world to reach others for Christ.
There's a certain amount of risk that missionary pilots may encounter.
Places that have not been reached by the gospel, they're hard to reach. In many cases, dangerous to reach.
People who are living in great spiritual darkness.
The island of Papua, basically in the middle of the jungle, in the middle of nowhere.
When we first went in there 14 years ago, I thought, that seriously cannot be an airstrip.
An airstrip at a village is an important milestone in their spiritual relationship with God.
I would love to bring the airplane back here. So please, please, finish the work.
Tim and I both came to bring a people group into the kingdom.
The gospel coming to the people of Papua is way more important than even my life.
I just got a message. A plane went down in a lake.
There's been an accident.
We had an airplane missing. It's worth doing what we can do to see Christ change their hearts.
This is worth giving your life for.
It worked.
Beyond anything we can imagine, this is an opportunity and a privilege of spreading the greatest news in the world to the ends of the earth.
So that gives you a little bit of a snapshot of what they do. Nathan, go ahead and come and share with us this morning.
Hey, good morning, everybody. Thanks for the opportunity to come and bring my family back here again and share and talk with you. And it's a little embarrassing to watch yourself sometimes on the screen like that. I had a speech teacher in college, a professor that basically told me that I've got the face for radio and the voice for print. And so it's interesting now to see where the Lord's taken that and the fact that I get to be in this documentary and be a part of what God's doing too on the island of Papua. So this morning, I just wanted to share a little bit with you about our work and what we do and what the Lord is doing over there, because it is absolutely amazing. I feel very blessed and honored and privileged to be over there. A lot of times people think that we sacrifice and we're through the muck and the worst parts of ministry, and sometimes it feels that way, but then you get to see a glimpse of what God's doing in people's lives and changing cultures, And you're just like, Lord, thank you so much for this opportunity. So I want to share with you a little bit of a verse and then kind of expound on what it looks like to get the gospel to some of these places. So today I'll read out of Matthew 9, 35 through 38. I'm only going to read the first couple of verses first. And it says, Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, healing every disease and every affliction. And then the verse that really seems to be a theme that I see a lot right now in Papua is, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. So I wanted to discuss a little bit about like what I see as the five stages of a village coming to the Lord and having that the gospel presented and then maturing into a fully functioning church. So the first stage is pretty simple. It sees unreached groups, people that haven't been able to hear about Jesus. Some of them haven't even heard the word Jesus. It's amazing that over in Papua, now, if you can imagine, our side of the island, the Indonesian part of Papua, in terms of like geographic square mileage, we're just slightly smaller than the state of California here. And within that island, there are just under 300 different language, distinct and different language groups. So take the size of California, put 300 different language groups in there, and that's what we've got on our island. And at times, it's pretty amazing. Like, you guys are centered in a valley here, and it's beautiful. But it also reminds me, there are times that you could be standing on one side of the valley with a village and being over there with a people group, and you can look across the way on the other side of the mountains, and there's a village over there that speaks a totally different language and has a totally different culture, and the two villages are unable to communicate with each other. The airplane, though, brings access to the gospel. It brings access to outside medicine, outside food. And what we found is that with those unreached people groups, the airplane can change them both culturally, it can change them both physically and spiritually, in a lot of ways for the better. And what's amazing is that the gospel's been on the island now for about 70 years, and as it's reached some of these unreached groups, their neighbors are able to see the difference. And I want to talk about a few of those differences. The first one is physical difference. I have the unique privilege to fly over the island. And as I look down, I get to see these different tribes. And one of the things I've recognized is that where the airplane has been, where it's been the longest, where missionaries have come in and brought the gospel, brought access to Western medicine, things like that, you see the populations explode. So usually you can tell where the gospel's been just by the size of the village. And one of those reasons is, without the airplane, without missionaries, without the gospel, infant mortality rate over there is about 80 to 90%, meaning about 9 out of 10 kids don't make it to the age of 2. They oftentimes don't even give their kids names until they're over the 2 years of age, because why? They're just going to pass away anyway. So with the airplane, with the medicine, with the missionaries, with the gospel, we can get that down to about 10 to 15%. Now, it still seems high, especially to us in the Western world. You know, that's still one out of every 10 kids still doesn't make it till 2. But for them, it means the population explodes. Even within a generation, the people will look around and be like, there are so many kids. And it's just great to see that physical transformation of a village. But also, spiritually, it changes them to the point where their neighbors notice. If you guys were here 5 years ago, I talked about, you know, two villages that would fight each other and often, you know, end up eating each other, right? And how the gospel can come in and within a generation go from fighting to marrying one another, right? And that's awesome. But the thing is, the neighbors notice that. And so what we're finding now is, you know, 70 years ago, you would go into a tribe and you'd have to start almost from scratch to be able to bring the gospel and to talk about some of this stuff. But now we have testimonies of different villages around that their neighbors are like, there's something different here. What do they have that I don't? What am I missing? And so they are now actively pursuing the gospel. They're actively asking for people to come in. And one of those tribes was in the documentary, you know. They spent 15 years building an airstrip in the hopes that the airstrip would attract missionaries or evangelists to be able to bring that gospel in and tell them what they are missing, because they noticed something's different. They noticed that something's absent from their life. And so that is just phenomenal, right? But as a pilot, I'm also noticing that the laborers are few. We oftentimes don't have enough workers to be able to meet the demand. When I go back in just a few weeks, I know already on my desk there are 12 new airstrips asking for the plane to come in, asking for missionaries, asking for evangelists. And I also know we don't have the people to manage that, to get in there to do the work. And part of it is because the work's hard. So first stage is no contact or unreached peoples. Now, they can be anywhere from brand new tribes to ones that are just neighbors and can see the villages, but have not heard the gospel. The second stage is when we finally get missionaries into that village. So the missionary's job, once they get there, is just to learn the language and learn the culture. And that is a full-time job. Learning language is stupidly difficult. It is just amazing how tough it is. And so as the pilot, as the one in the airplane, my job is really to support those missionaries during that time. Their full-time job is language learning. So they don't have time to go gardening. They don't have time to go hunting. They have no way to get food. Where they're at, there's no grocery stores. The people there subsist on their gardens, like sweet potatoes, and the occasional pig they can shoot. And you know, that's not enough for the missionaries. They got to spend their time learning the language. And so the airplane's there to bring in food, bring in supplies, and be that support while they're spending their full time learning the language. And learning the language is just, like I said, it's awful. There is one people group that we go to, Turu. Their language is tonal. And so if you don't know what a tonal language is, and I didn't until I was talking to these missionaries, the same word, depending on the inflection, changes the meaning. So if you say a word and it goes up at the end, that's one meaning. If it goes down at the end, it's a different one. And if it starts up and then goes down, that's different, or down and then up. And as somebody that's tone deaf, I can't tell the difference. And that's really tough. And for a while, the missionaries themselves didn't even know the difference. And so my friend's telling me a story, and he always likes this one, because over there, their word for boat and their word for fart is exactly the same, minus the inflection point. And he didn't find this out until he was asking his friend if he could borrow his fart to go up the river. You know, he's like, is it all right if I get into your fart? Is your fart still leaking? You know, and the guys just laugh. The kids always love that joke, right? The people are just laughing at him. And he can't figure out why, because he's like, this is the word for boat, right? What's the word for boat? And they'd say it again, and he's like, that's what I'm saying, right? So then to have six different tones that you've got to hear through all of that. And not now, you take those six different tones, and you've got to develop an alphabet and take grammar and everything else and do that all from scratch. You know, if I want to learn Spanish or French or some other language, I can pull out my phone, find an app, and man, that app will help me in my spare time. Or if I want, I can go find somebody else that speaks that language and that can tutor me. Or I can read about it. Over there, outside of these people groups, nobody else speaks that language. There is no written language. The people themselves don't really understand even the concept of grammar. It's just intuitive, but they've never had to think through that or write it down. So the missionaries have to learn that language, write the alphabet, start understanding grammar. That's tough. That's tough to do from scratch. But then you also have to throw in the idea of context, because the people over there, they think differently, and their world is different. So there's one tribe that they live in the swamps in the lowlands, and the missionary was like, okay, I'm trying to figure out prepositions here, right, or just phrases. So I'm going to figure out if I wanted to say this thing is in front of another thing, how do I do that? So he got a basket, and he turned to his friend, and he took his basket, and he took a rock, and he put that rock in front of the basket, and he said, okay, where is this rock in relation to the basket? And the guy says, up. He's like, oh, okay, I wrote that. And he turned to his other friend, and he put the rock in front of the basket, and just to double check, he said, where's this rock? And the guy said, out. And I was like, all right, well, that was up, and this is out. Well, what does this guy say? So he does it again. He puts it out here, and he said, where's the rock? And the person said, down. And so he's like, well, wait a minute. What's going on? Am I asking the wrong question? And he was trying to figure out why he keeps getting different answers. And it took about a year for him to finally realize that for them, their whole world is based on the river that runs next to their village. So when he turned to this guy and he put the rock there, the guy relates the rock to the basket based on the river. So the rock is upriver from the basket. When he turned this way, the rock is out. It's away from the river, and here it's downriver. So again, sometimes even just the way they think or the way they view the world, you have to be able to understand all that, especially if you're going to be telling the story of Jesus and sharing the gospel with people. And so it just takes time. So for them, they learn the language, they learn the context, and then the first thing they do with that is they start teaching people how to read. They teach them their language and teach them how to read. And again, this process takes anywhere from 3 years up to 8 years, depending on the difficulty of the language and how talented the missionaries are as they're studying. So it takes a long time, and it's tough too, because during that time, you don't have believers there. You don't have friends in the village, because most of the time they just look at you as a source of food or other ways to get things, and it can be exhausting and draining. And this is where we often see a lot of the missionaries step out of the field, because it's tough and it's thankless, and you just don't see any fruit yet because you're spending all your time with the language. So, third stage, though, is the exciting stage. That's when you get to be able to share the gospel. When you finally have got the language down, you've been working on literacy, what they'll do in most of the villages is they do a chronological teaching. So they start translating some of the stories from the Bible, starting in Genesis, and then working through the major points of the Old Testament, and then up into the New Testament through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And that time period of them sharing from Genesis to Jesus takes about 3 months. It's a long time. They invite everybody, and they sit down and go through this. Usually they'll teach in the morning, and then in the afternoon they'll be available to answer questions and talk to people. And it oftentimes is amazing what the Lord does during that time. I want to share with you a story of a village in Bina. We were working with the missionaries there, and they had been sharing the stories for the last 3 months. They were getting close to the part about Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. And, you know, the people had been pretty stoic at that point. They'd been listening, but the response had been fairly, I don't want to say tepid, but just, they're just listening. It's hard to sometimes get feedback from them. So they finished on a Friday, and they were like, look, we're going to share the important thing on Monday. Everybody needs to come. What you're going to hear is the whole reason we're here. Please come. And what is amazing is that Sunday night, before the message of the gospel, it rained harder than it's ever rained in the village. And the ground, it shook. And the lightning and the thunder were intense to the where the people were scared. And they said, wow, this is God doing something. This must be important. And so the whole village that Monday comes ready, because they said, the Lord knows this is important. He showed us this was important. And they came on Monday to hear the gospel. And hearing that gospel, you know, they had multiple believers in that village because of the Lord demonstrating his power. And then once that gospel comes, though, the change it brings about in the culture is amazing. We talked a little bit about, you know, cannibals, but even more than that, what we see is that when the gospel comes, anytime a culture is, the further away a culture is from the gospel, the ones that suffer the most are the women and the children. And we see that constantly in the tribes. Oftentimes, women are not valued, kids are not valued. One tribe said, you know, when they heard the gospel, they were finally like, oh, women aren't just soulless, mindless husks. They're actually, you know, have value. The gospel changes their perception of how they view themselves and the people in their village. I want to share with you a story of what that looks like, especially for kids, and how the gospel can bring these people from darkness into light. And I share this story, this first story, while they're still in darkness, and I want you to understand what happens is pretty horrible. And we would look at it like, I can't believe this mom would abuse her kid this way. But you got to understand that to her it was an act of love. So this mom, because of the child infant mortality rate, had lost 6 kids before the age of 2. The husband really wanted a son, but was angry at the wife because she wasn't able to keep her kids alive. So she got pregnant again for the 7th time, and she gave birth to a daughter, and the dad was like, just, you might as well kill her now. She's not going to live, and I wanted a son anyway. And the mom was like, no, I'll do all I can to keep her alive. And so she named her daughter Madhu, which in that language means worm. And she took string and tied it around both pinkies of her infant's fingers so that the blood would be cut off and the fingers would fall off. And then she took a knife and went up the arm and up the face, making scars. And all of that was so that the spirits would find the baby ugly and would keep her alive and would not take her. And that, again, was an act of, in her mind, an act of love. But it's because they are in that darkness, they're in that fear of the spirits, and don't have Jesus and understanding that. I'll end on that story just to look real quickly here. And as an aside, they have the gospel now, and Madhu is a believer. And it's so fun to talk to her when, you know, she's reading about Jesus going to prepare a place for her and how there's a place in her father's house, especially with a father that did not want her, that kicked her out. So it's cool to see. But bringing that gospel in causes that transformation. And so when the gospel came to this place in Bina, after the storm and the earthquakes and the rock slides and all that, and God demonstrating his power, one of the things they saw really quickly is that they're naming ceremonies for their kids. They went from fearing the spirits taking their child to sitting down with the missionaries and being like, we want to do something different with our kids. We recognize who they are and the value they have from the Lord, and we want to have a naming ceremony that reflects that. And so they sat down together, and the first dad stands up, and there's about like six families here. The first dad stands up, holds his kid up, and says, my wife and I have been wanting a child for a while, and God heard us and gave us one. So I'm going to name our child God Hears. And he sat down, and another guy stood up, and he said, God showed compassion on me and my wife and gave us another child. I'm going to name my daughter Compassion. And they went around the circle, and these group of believers named their kids after the attributes of God. And it's just so cool to see that transformation from, you know, one, not naming your kids until you're two, or fearing the spirits that you have to name or damage your child to keep them alive, to using it as an act of worship and celebration of who God is. It's amazing to be there to see that cultural change. Becky often talks about it as almost being a physical thing. You can tell when you step into a village that has yet to hear the gospel and go to one that has. There is a connection you have with the people there. There's a physical, tangible difference, and it's cool to be a part of. It's fun for me to be the pilot to go in before and after and see that transformation. So after they've received the gospel, what's the fourth stage? The fourth stage is all about translation and discipleship. In this stage, it's kind of the longest stage, and oftentimes it's not as like glamorous. Because, again, translating the Bible just takes a long time. Oftentimes, guys will spend weeks on just a handful of verses trying to figure out, how do I communicate this in a different language? What does it look like when a culture has no concept or idea of the word forgiveness? You know, to them, you don't forgive. There is no idea that if someone takes your pig, you go take one back. If someone injures you, you go injure them back. Sometimes the idea of love, there's no word for love. So how do you express that, especially when you're talking about God? So you're working through some of these passages. Something as simple, too, is, you know, Jesus is the bread of life. How does that work when they've never seen bread? Jesus is the Lamb of God. That's, you know, they've never seen a lamb. To them, their main source of food, of any animal there, is a pig. So do you want to say Jesus is the pig of God? How does that work? You know, especially when in Indonesia, where it's a mostly Islamic country, you got to be careful of some of those things. So translation oftentimes can take a long period. So that with the airplane, then I'm usually in helping them, supporting them with that, and then I'm flying translations out and people out so they can go to the big city, work with some translation specialists, make sure that what they're doing is correct. It goes back and forth through a process. And then normally, we try and get the scripture out as fast as possible. So something gets translated, a book gets translated, and we will print it, and I get to fly that in and pass it out. And man, that's a fun flight. I always enjoy those flights. It's so cool to see believers that, you know, up until a few years ago couldn't read, didn't have anything in their own language, to be able to crack open, you know, something like the book of Matthew and start reading it for the first time in their own language. It's cool to be a part of that. I at one point was sitting in with a group as they were reading through Revelation for the first time, talking about Jesus being proud of his bride and showing her off, the bride, the church. And again, reading through that and then recognizing I need to be proud of my bride and what that does as they see the Word of God and see how that can influence and affect their culture. I remember getting all teary and emotional just because I was so full of joy. And one of the guys leaned over to the missionary and he's like, is he okay? Why is he crying? And the missionary wisely was like, you know, this is the culmination of all so much work, so much effort. And the part to be a part of that was just so amazing and cool. It's a fun thing to see. But again, that's not the end, right? We want to have a Bible translated. We want that word there so that when the missionary leaves, the people can still go back to something. Because what we've seen in the past sometimes is if the Bible doesn't get translated, you might have believers. You might be able to come in and share the gospel, but then over time, if there's not the scripture, it gets watered down or it gets influenced by other cultural aspects or some of the norms they used to have start creeping back in. And by the second generation, you have some nominal Christians, and by the third generation, they're back to their old ways. And so having the scripture in their own language is important. I think on the island of Papua, we only have 7 complete Bible translations out of those 275 to 300 languages. Now, we have a lot of partial translations, but that translation process can take up to 30 years. And so you can imagine the commitment of somebody's life to go through learning that language, sharing the gospel, and then working on a full translation to make sure these people have it in their own language. That's a 40-year commitment. And we've been a part of, I think, 2 Bible celebrations, and it's fun to do it, but it's people my dad's age that have been there since 60s, 70s, working on this project. And it's fun to see the culmination of that. But it's not the end, as like I said. The end is the idea of having a mature church that is sending out its own evangelists. And that's a hard stage to get to when the spiritual children of the missionaries are making basically spiritual grandbabies, right? That's where we want. We want those people to be able to share the gospel in a way that others understand and come to the Lord. And if you haven't seen the documentary, sorry, I'm going to spoil it a little bit, because I want to talk about that, because it loops back into the first stage and what we're trying to do over there now with getting these people, getting the nationals trained up and ready. Because for them, they already know the language, they already know the culture, they understand how the people think, and they can bypass some of those second and third stages a lot faster than a Western missionary can. But in this documentary, I get to fly in 2 evangelist families into the village of Puluk. Puluk, again, had been waiting years. They built an airstrip for 15 years. They'd been telling the missionaries, please send someone, and we just didn't have a way to do that. We didn't have evangelists ready. It was tough. It's tough to see that desire and not be able to do anything about it. But thankfully on this flight, I was able to. So I got to fly in these 2 evangelists, and the people of Puluk were like, oh, we weren't ready for you yet. We didn't know you were coming. Please give us a couple weeks. We want to make sure that everybody can come in from their gardens or those guys out hunting. Let us go out and gather everybody so that we can hear the teaching. So the evangelists are like, sure, go for it. Because, you know, the people are slightly nomadic, and they're not always grouped together at one time. So the evangelists waited 2 weeks as everyone started coming in out of the jungle and filing down. And they started through the chronological teaching. And you got to understand, too, like I said, most of these people subsist off of what they can get from their gardens or what they can get while they're out hunting. It's not a place you go, you don't have like refrigerators and freezers, and so they're not stockpiling their food. They're having to get it not quite daily, but mostly every other day. And because of where they live, sometimes finding places to be able to garden or to be able to hunt, it's not just, you know, in your backyard. Oftentimes it's a hike away. They'll often have like second homes out at the garden because it takes so long to get out there. By the time you do the work or you harvest, it's already dark and you can't get back. So when they're gathered together and they're hearing the gospel for the first time, nobody wanted to leave, but they're running out of food. And, you know, over there, hospitality is a huge thing. And so they were apologizing to the evangelist, like, we don't have any food to give you. But again, nobody wanted to do anything about it. They were so desperate for the gospel that they stayed there for 3 months, subsisting only on what they could scavenge around just the village. And again, it was incredible to see that that hunger for the word, for that desire to hear more about Jesus. So this village is maybe about 125, 130 people all gathered together. And some of that's kids, but the evangelists share for 3 months. They're going through, and they share the gospel for the first time. And 78 new believers accept Jesus. And that's most, if not all, of the men and women in that village. And it's just a cool thing to see that they have this desire, this hunger. They accept the word when they've heard it. And then the evangelists are like, okay, we know you guys have not eaten. It's been forever. Everybody's hungry. So what we're going to do, we're going to divide you up into two groups. We want to talk to you a little bit more about what it means to be a Christian, what that's like, and make sure you understand exactly what we've been teaching. So we're dividing you up into two groups. So that way one group can be here for the teaching, and the second group can go out and get food, right? And then in a few weeks we'll swap, and so people can eat for the first time. So that night they gather together, and again, nobody had left. Both groups were staying there because nobody wanted to miss the teaching. And it's important. It's important, you know, as we talk about all these different language groups, 275 to 300 on our island, hearing the gospel in your own language matters. And so all that work from the stage two of learning the language to preaching it in the word to translating the gospel in these people's languages, it's a lot of work, a lot of effort, but it's important. One of the people in Puluk, an older gentleman, they know they're missing something, and they're not getting evangelists. So he's like, I'm going to go to the neighboring tribe and try and hear and understand so I can come back and share. We know we're missing something. So they speak Wano, the language of Wano, and he's going over to the tribe over the mountains, and they speak Damal. And so he goes and he learns about Jesus in the Damal language, but he understands basically nothing. But he knows how to teach in the Damal language. So he comes back to his people group that speaks Wano, and he starts teaching in Damal. And again, nobody understands, but they're trying. There's that heart, there's that desire. So when the evangelists come and they start preaching, this pastor, this elder of the village, he gets up and he takes off his shirt. Oops, excuse me. He takes off his shirt. And he says, this is like me taking off my authority and giving it to them. He's like, I apologize to all of you. I have done a poor job of teaching. These people, they have the word. And he was one of the first believers when they shared the gospel for the first time. And to me, it's just amazing to see that humbleness, that recognition, and that quick acceptance when he's heard the truth. And now he's an older guy, and he was telling me in his testimony, he's like, you know, I've thought for years now I was going to die. He's like, I should have died by now. But if I had died before, I would have gone to hell. I know that now. But now I'm going to go to heaven. And he said, I was like Simeon. And the Lord kept Simeon alive so that he could meet Jesus at the temple. And in the same way, God has kept me alive so that I could hear his word. One of the women there, too, was saying, like, she's like, I faithfully attended church. I would come in every Sunday. I would be here. But I would walk in that door. I would sit down, and I would not understand a single thing. And when I got up and I walked out the door, it would be out and gone, and I would not even know what I heard and could not remember. But she said, now that the evangelists have come and that they've shared with me the gospel in my own language, excuse me, she's like, I understand it and I remember it all the way from Genesis, all the way to the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. She said, I used to be like the seed on the hard ground where the birds would come and take it away. And she said, now I'm like the seed on the good ground. It's in my heart. And to me, to hear those testimonies, those simple, clear testimonies, is just an amazing privilege. And I thank the Lord for that. So that's the goal, though, is to get those evangelists to come back and be able to share with the people in their own language. If you get to watch the documentary, you'll notice that through those five stages, it's not just a single missionary. It's not just a single person. It takes a team. We talk about it that oftentimes in these villages, there's anywhere from 2 to 4 families working on the language, working on the translations, working on discipleship. So you have them in the village, then you have the airplane that comes in and supports them. And from the airplane, you have mechanics and finance and IT guys, and the missionaries themselves have supply buyers. And then all of us, too, have people back here in the States, like the church here, that support us, that pray for us, that are a part of that team that help reach these unreached people groups. And so we want to just say thank you to all of you for that, for being a part of our team, for being a part of the gospel coming to these remote parts of the world. And so I want to encourage you, too, with the last part of this chapter of Matthew, where, you know, Jesus looks out and he sees this multitude, and he feels compassion for them. And I feel like that's where we're at. When I've got these 12 airstrips, and these are just the completed airstrips. These are the ones that they say are ready for an airplane to come in. And there's multiple other ones that are under construction or that are asking for missionaries to come in, asking for evangelists. I look around and I see this multitude hungry for the word. And I look at my fellow laborers and there's not enough. And so the last part of Matthew 9 says, "Then Jesus said to his disciples, 'The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest.'" And I feel as a church, like, this is what I would want to challenge you with. You know, a lot of people are like, what can we pray for you about? What can we do? We know not everybody's called to be over there. Not everybody can be over there, and that's fine. We all can play a part. And for us, as we go back, October 10th is the day we go back, I ask that you guys could be praying this prayer for Papua. Because we see the harvest is plentiful. We see the desire. We see the need for workers to reach these people. So I would just ask that you guys be praying for that. The Lord would raise up workers to go into this harvest because it's ready. It's there. And we just need people that will be able to commit most, if not all, of their lives to this task. Very thankful for my family and my ability to be out there to witness a lot of this, to be a part of it. So thank you as a church for helping us do that. Sometimes I feel overly blessed and privileged because I get to see God move and work in just amazing, amazing ways. So again, as we're here, we'll be happy to answer any questions you guys have for us. We're just happy to be back again and see you all after 5 years. And just again, want to say thank you for your faithful support, for your prayers, and just the way you guys have loved us as we've been over there. And that's all I've got for the day. You want me to sit? No.
So when we go to lunch, you guys have questions for them, talk with them, you know, sit with them. I'm going to dismiss Nathan and Becky first to go up there and get their food so that they can actually eat something. So it's not like the village where we have to wait 3 months to eat, so they can do that right there. But just in closing, this is what I want to challenge each and every one of you to. Nathan has said, pray that the Lord would send workers in the harvest. Pray for that, but be open to what God might tell you. There are some of you, we always talk when we do missionary stuff, we talk about, like, there's 3 things we can do. We can give, pray, or go. And some people are going to do all 3. Some can only do one of those. But as we wrap up today, understand that the gifts that you guys have given over the years to Nathan and Becky has helped them in their ministry. Understand that what we take in a love offering today is going to help them get where they're going. It's going to help them pay for, I mean, to come back to the United States, I think it's, what, $1,500 per ticket for them to fly back. And so, I mean, there's nothing about this that's cheap. So if the Lord has put it in your heart to give, give this morning as we take our love offering. Certainly be praying, but then also take this into consideration. There are some of you here, some of our young people, maybe some of our not so young people, that the Lord has given you abilities. We have pilots in this church. We have people that want to be pilots in this church. Like, it's a long journey, but, you know, to get there and to be a part of what God's doing is an incredible thing. We have people in this church that, you know, you might not even know it yet, but maybe you're somebody that could go out there and sit down in that village and learn the language and start the translation process. And, you know, these are things that God is doing to win a people to himself. You know, when it talks in the book of Revelation about there being a multitude of every nation, tribe, and tongue, Nathan and the missionaries over here in Indonesia and Becky and all of them, they're helping to build that up. God is using them to build up his inheritance of nations from every nation, tribe, and tongue. And that's an incredible thing to be a part of. But also know, everybody here that's contributed and been a part of this, you're doing that too. Everyone that goes and prays for them as they head back to Indonesia, you're a part of that. So just be open to what it is that God would have you to do as part of what's going on here in Indonesia. We're going to have the praise team come back up, and we're going to close this morning with a song entitled Carry Your Name, and that's the goal, right? We're all wanting to take the gospel forward, to make disciples of all nations, you know, teaching them, baptizing them. This is the call that we have on our lives. And so Nathan and Becky, I'm going to excuse you guys to head up to the fellowship hall. There's people already up there. I'll meet you guys all at the door after we sing this morning. And if the Lord has placed it on your heart to contribute both to the ministries of this church, but also to the love offering on the way out, drop those in the receptacle. Go ahead and stand, and let's sing together one last song this morning.
God's only Son, Jesus.
All right, thank you for being here this morning. Please stick around for lunch. If the Lord's put it on your heart, contribute, love offering, regular offering, and I will see you guys at the door. Wait, what's that? Oh, yeah, hold on. Let me pray for the meal. That way you can go over there and just eat, and you don't have to sit around and wait until I get up there. So let me pray for that meal, and then you're dismissed. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day. Lord, we're so grateful for the time that we got to spend hearing from Nathan about what you're doing in Papua, Indonesia. And Lord God, I just pray that you just get a hold of our hearts, that we would want to be a part of that we would want to contribute to that we would want to maybe even give our lives for that very purpose there, Lord. And maybe it's not Indonesia you've called us to, Lord. Maybe you've called us to just here, to give our lives fully to you here in this place. Lord God, I just pray that we would listen, that we would be receptive to what you are calling us to do. Lord, I pray that this morning you would bless the food that we're about to receive, bless the time that we're about to have, and just, Lord, let it be an encouragement to our hearts and an encouragement to our missionaries. Lord, we love you. We thank you for all you do. Bless the food. Bless our time. In Jesus' name, amen.